Hey everyone, for today's video, we'll be doing some benchmark runs with some of the best PC hardware that money can buy today, with the key highlight being, you saw that right, a 32GB DDR5 7200 RAM kit by Kingston. Let's get started. Right, so the folks over at ASUS Singapore have kindly sent over some top-of-the-range PC hardware, and I'll be putting them all together on my test bench to see what kind of performance we're gonna get with a mixture of synthetic and gaming benchmarks. First up, we've got Intel's Core i9-13900K, which is the company's flagship consumer product offering sitting at the top of the 13th generation Raptor Lake product stack with 8 performance cores, 16 efficient cores, and a maximum turbo frequency of 5.8GHz. Cooling this beast of a processor is going to be no easy task, and to that end, we've got the new ASUS ROG Ryuo 3 360 ARGB liquid cooler, which features Acertec's latest 8th generation pump solution. To harness the power of the 13900K, we've got a premium Intel Z790 motherboard offering on hand, the ASUS ROG Maximus Z790 Hero, which has high-end features such as 20+1 power stages rated for up to 90 amps, dual PCIe 5.0 x16 slots, dual Thunderbolt 4 ports, and the list goes on. This setup wouldn't be complete without the most powerful consumer GPU on the market right now, NVIDIA's GeForce RTX 4090, in the guise of the ASUS ROG Strix GeForce RTX 4090 OC Edition 24GB GDDR6X. It sports a factory overclock right off the bat, has a chunky cooling solution with a die-cast metal shroud, AxioTech fans, and some really nice looking RGB accents which you can catch a glimpse of later in this video. Now to top all of this off, ASUS has also sent over some RAM, Kingston's Fury Renegade DDR5. We're talking about two 16GB DDR5 7200 sticks for a total of 32GB of RAM. As you can see, these are engineering samples. The DDR5 7200 variants of the Fury Renegade DDR5 are not yet available for purchase by the public as of the time of producing this video, so it should be interesting to see how these RAMs will perform. With that, let's put all these parts together on the test bench. Right, so here we have it, the components all assembled together on the test bench. Running through the other specs of this test setup, I'm using a spare Crucial P3 500GB NVMe SSD of mine as the primary drive. I know, it's not exactly a high-end SSD given that it's a DRAM-less design, uses the PCIe 3.0 X4 interface and QLC NAND flash, but given the nature of the benchmark tests, this SSD should do just fine. In terms of power supply, I've got Cooler Master's V1000 Gold dishing out the juice for the components of this setup, and to round things off, Windows 11 Pro version 2.1H2 for the OS. Delving a little deeper into the BIOS settings, I've left the power limits on the stock motherboard settings where MCE, also known as Multi-Core Enhancement and controls the power limits for the processor, is set to auto by default. I've also selected the XMP1 profile with the Kingston RAMs running at DDR5 7200 speeds with the default timings that you see on the screen. Do note that resizable BAR was also enabled for the entirety of the benchmark process. Now in terms of benchmarks, we'll start with a suite of synthetic benchmarks with Cinebench R23 to test the processing power of this setup, followed by Ada64 to check out the performance of the Kingston DDR5 7200 RAMs. We'll then move on to 3DMark TimeSpy, TimeSpy Extreme, as well as CPU profile tests before proceeding on to some gaming benchmarks. For this purpose, I'll be using the in-game benchmarks of Cyberpunk 2077, Far Cry 6, as well as Shadow of the Tomb Raider to gain a quick sensing of how this setup will perform in terms of its gaming prowess. Do note that I've cranked up the graphics settings for these games to the absolute maximum for all tests with upscaling technologies such as DLSS and FSR switched off, and I'll be running the tests at the 1440p resolution as I unfortunately do not have a 4K monitor with me. With that, let's get started with the benchmarks. First up, we've got Cinebench R23, which is a benchmark that tests the rendering prowess of a processor. The system scores a whopping 39,169 points for the multi-core test and 2,189 points for the single-core test. In terms of clock behavior during the multi-core test, according to the readouts from Hardware Info 64, we see that the 13900K maintained a P-core frequency of around 5.4 GHz and an E-core frequency of around 4.3 GHz. During the benchmark, the CPU package temperature was around 90 degrees Celsius, and this was with a beefy 360mm AIO liquid cooler for the CPU. Toasty toasty. Next up, to test the memory performance for this setup, we've got the results from Ada64 on the screen, where you can see that the Kingston DDR5 7200 modules put up a pretty good showing, with a read performance of 107,410 MB/s, a write performance of 94,541 MB/s, and a copy performance of 96,928 MB/s. Pretty speedy results, I must say. For those of you wondering about the brand of DRAM that Kingston uses for these two sticks of RAM, a quick check using CPU-Z reveals that they use SK Hynix chips. Moving on, we've got 3DMark TimeSpy benchmark, which is a DirectX 12 benchmark that tests the capabilities of a PC's processor and graphics card. We see that the system gets a TimeSpy score of 34,045, with a graphics score of 37,356 and a CPU score of 22,664. Moving on to TimeSpy Extreme, which is the same TimeSpy benchmark but rendered at 4K resolution instead, we see that the system gets a score of 18,485 with a graphics score of 19,800 and a CPU score of 13,433. Coming right up is 3DMark CPU profile test, which shows how one CPU performance changes and scales with the number of cores and threads used. The system achieves the scores that you see on the screen. And with that, onto some gaming benchmarks, with Cyberpunk 2077's built-in gaming benchmark, where as you can see, I've maxed out the graphics settings on the 1440p resolution with the Psycho Ray Tracing setting and DLSS and FSR switched off, the system gets a healthy average FPS of 81.45, a minimum FPS of 63.97, and a maximum FPS of 112.25, not a bad showing at all. Moving on to Far Cry 6, again on the 1440p resolution with all graphics settings maxed out, and with ray tracing enabled and FSR disabled, we see that the system pumps out a healthy average FPS of 145, a minimum FPS of 124, and a maximum FPS of 199. Rounding off the gaming benchmarks, we've got Shadow of the Tomb Raider, where as you can see, we're on the 1440p resolution with all graphics settings maxed out and ray tracing shadows set to the ultra quality, and of course, DLSS and FSR disabled, and the system puts out an average FPS of 174. And there you have it, a very solid set of performance scores. No surprises really that a 13900K with 32GB of DDR5 7200 RAM and a factory overclocked RTX 4090 would make for an absolute beast of a gaming PC. The only downside? The massive power bill that you'll be racking up, especially given how power hungry the 13900K and RTX 4090 are under load. To give a sensing of the power consumption for the system, I had a quick look at the Hardware Info 64 logs while I was playing Cyberpunk 2077 single player on this test setup, and the 13900K drew 131 watts of power on average, while the RTX 4090 drew an average of 421 watts of power. Ouch. So yes, all that gaming and productivity prowess does indeed come at a significant energy cost. With that, thank you so much for watching, hit the like button and get subscribed if you've enjoyed this video, and I'll catch you guys around the next time.